to be loved and love at the highest count means to lose all the things I can't live without. Let it be known that I will choose to lose. It's a sacrifice.
Bonnie Winokur, born in 1944, lived in Chelsea as a kid, lived in many different apartments throughout Boston and the Metro West area, and met Mary in 1984. We got together in 87, and we've been together ever since. It comes to about 34 years. Started teaching in 1965. I was already out as a lesbian. I came out when I was 18 years old. It was very difficult because you could have been fired if they would have found out. So I lived two lives, and I lied a lot. Things got easier in the 90s, and I began to tell certain people. But prior to that, from the 60s to the 90s, was very difficult. I loved teaching. I loved the kids. I love seeing you guys around. It makes me feel back.
Like she's back teaching without the work. I grew up in Medford, and I was married for 23 years. I have a daughter, a son who's a science teacher, and another son, and three granddaughters. I did the original research on birth control pills in the 60s.
Wow.
Best job I ever had in my life.
Medford is a wonderful, diverse community. There are a lot of gay people in Maynard, and we're very welcome in the community. I've never felt any discrimination in this town whatsoever. Do you have any other questions?
So the audience for this is high school students. So what was high school like for you guys?
Episode of Maday's Maynard Breakdown, where I break down a play from one of Maynard's games. For the first episode, we'll be breaking down a play from the football team. This play was from our game against Oakmont. This is the opening play of the game. Start out by going into a 3-by-1 formation, which means we have three receivers to one side, one receiver to the other. We're then going to motion the running back out of the backfield over here. Here's the motion. Oakmont's running a 3-4 defense, which means they have three defensive linemen, which would be these three guys with their hand in the dirt, and these four are linebackers. Because they have seven guys in the box, that means they can only have four guys to cover the four receivers. So this corner is on this wide receiver, this overhang is on this number two receiver, this safety is on this wide receiver, and this corner is on this wide receiver. When we motion out, because there's no extra help, this linebacker has to bump over and this cornerback has to bump over. Here we're going to have Owen run a skinny post, and the defense now has to communicate who's got who, as we've essentially created a stack, as these two guys could go in any direction, and Oakmont's not quite able to communicate everything, as this corner doesn't know late that he's picking up Owen, and that this linebacker is taking the wheel from Hirsch. Because of that, this corner is out leveraged. He's outside of Owen, who's running an in-breaking route away from the leverage by design. Let's rewind a bit to rewatch the play. Here's the motion. They have to bump, they have to communicate. Connor just has to drop the ball over the shoulder for a long 62-yard pickup that will give the Tigers the good field position on the first drive of the game. Tigers get the ball down inside the red zone and would score a few plays later. That's all for this episode of Maday's Maynard Breakdown, as I hope you enjoyed me breaking down the first play from the Oakmont game. I'm Johnny Maday, and I'll see you next time for episode 2 of Maday's Maynard Breakdown.
And today we're going over the three best new gen anime of the last 2 years. Tokyo Revengers is one of the hottest animes in the world right now, with record-breaking sales, with over 1 million copies sold in the previous week. The basis of the show is where Takemichi, the main character, travels back in time to save his dead girlfriend. This is currently one of my favorite shows being made right now. Next we have Demon Slayer, currently the most popular sword fighting show in the world right now, due to its incredible animations and action sequences. Tanjiro, a 16-year-old boy who becomes a Demon Slayer to avenge his family and slay every demon that he comes across. In my opinion, this show will become number one quite soon. Last, we have Jujutsu Kaisen, which was released in 2020 and is the most popular anime in production right now. Itadori, a 17-year-old athletically tuned student, consumes a curse. By joining a school where they learn actually how to fight curses, he becomes stronger every single day. Thank you for tuning in, and now back to the studio.
I was feeling very nervous, but also confident because I've jumped 5'2 before, and in my head that's not that much, so it's just 1 inch. But yeah, it was my third attempt, so I'd already missed two, and you only get 3 tries, so it's kind of a make it or break it moment, so I was very, very nervous. So I set up just like any other jump. I did a few, I guess I rocked forward and back just to kind of get myself mentally prepared. And then I went in, I turned or I did the curve, I don't know, and then I jumped right up and over and it felt very smooth, almost as if I was flying through the air. And when I hit the mat, I was very, very excited because the bar did not fall. I was ecstatic, as the video might show. I was kind of jumping up and down, and I sprinted over to all my friends to celebrate with them because I seemed to have collected quite a fan club of younger kids that were just cheering me on. So I went right to them. I was like, and a lot of coaches came up congratulating me, which was very cool.
Fab Morvan and Rob Pilatus, the German and French R&B duo from Munich, Germany, known as Milli Vanilli. In 1988, they were approached by someone named Frank Farian, who offered them $4,000, and them being poor at the time, accepted to be the face of a new singing duo. Milli Vanilli took the world by storm, selling 7 million copies of their debut album, The Hits That Shocked the World. But they only lasted 2 years, and very quickly went from the most famous to the most infamous duo in music history, and here's why.
Despite being caught lip-syncing their songs, they went on to win 3 AMAs in the January of 1990.
And the winner is, girl, you know it's true, Milli Vanilli!
After winning their 3 AMAs, they went on to win a Grammy a month later. Fab and Rob then demanded they sing on the next album, but their manager said no.
This was due to the fact that they were currently under fire for being exposed, and the music would have sounded much different with different singers on the album.
Soon after their manager had said no to them singing on the next album, their record label was dropped from Arista Records.
Their Grammy was later revoked, and they were in danger of a lawsuit from their enraged fan.
Rob Pilatus unfortunately died at the age of 33 in Frankfurt, Germany.
One of the Ghost singers, John Davis, died of COVID-19 in Germany. Fab Morvan then tried to start a solo comeback.
He made his solo comeback in the early 2000s, releasing his album called Love Revolution. It never turned out good for him, but he now works as a DJ in Amsterdam and Los Angeles.
It was a regular Thursday night, November 18th, 2021. I was in bed, sleeping peacefully, not a care in the world. The next thing you know, I hear a big boom. This is the story of the Maynard Meteor Mayhem.
State your name.
Julia Hart.
And do you remember what you were doing at 10 p.m. on November 18th, 2021?
I believe I was sitting in my room on my floor doing homework.
And did you notice anything unusual about that night?
I remember hearing like a loud noise and I wasn't sure what it was, so I went downstairs to ask my parents and they also didn't know.
To this day, do you have any theories of what the loud noise could be?
It sounded like a bomb or something, but I don't know.
All right, thank you. State your name.
I'm Ronald Butler.
And do you remember what you were doing on November 18th, 2021 at 10 p.m.?
I was playing Xbox with my friends.
Did you notice anything unusual that happened that night?
Yeah, there was this big bang I heard. I could barely hear it because I was, the music was playing so loud, but I certainly heard it.
Did any of your friends text you that night or call you?
Yeah, my one friend Nick, he had texted me about hearing the same thing.
And to this day, do you have any theories of what this could have been?
Originally, I thought it was a gunshot or something, but it's not what other people think.
State your name.
I'm Wilbert Chow.
And do you remember what you were doing on November 18th, 2021 at 10 p.m.?
I was watching the Celtics game.
Did anything unusual happen that night?
Yeah, I did hear this weird explosion.
What did you think it was?
I thought it was gunshots from the Rod and Gun Club, because I hear those often.
And to this day, do you have any new theories of what this explosion could have been?
No, I haven't thought about it since.
All right, thank you.
Reports have come in from surrounding towns such as Acton and Sudbury and Concord and even Harvard about the mayhem they experienced that night.
But in the end, the leading theory is that a meteor hit over Middlesex County, according to Worcester Gazette.
We all know what a hard slap feels like, but imagine being slapped back and forth until you can't stand the stinging pain around your face. This week, we present Slap Boxing.
Slap boxing is like competitive slapping, or else that's what it's known as, but it's really similar to boxing. Slap boxing or competitive slapping is an often aggressive and brutal sport where only open hand slaps are allowed. Each opponent will take turns slapping the other. Now here's Diego with the rules.
Two guys will stand across from each other with a table in front of them and you will keep slapping your opponent as hard as you can until they give up or you get knocked out.
The sport has become so popular in recent years that the cash prize for competitive slapping competitions has risen to $500. Since the sport was only founded about a year ago, it can only grow more from there.
You will find slap boxing competitions mainly in Russia and here in the US.
As we end this segment, we'd like to show you the top five slaps that we found.
In at number four, we have a vicious slap, but it barely affects the opponent.
In at number three, the poor guy almost gets knocked out.
In at number two, the guy takes a nap.
In at number one, we have the dude with fake muscles getting absolutely knocked out.
Thanks for tuning in to this week's episode of The Wild. Tune in next week as we'll be looking at cheese rolling.
Use cranberry sauce bomb.
No, you're tricking me. Final move. Food coma activate. I'm sure he's just napping.
Welcome to Are You Smarter Than a Fowler Middle School? I'm your host, Cameron Junta, and today we will be using the Massachusetts curriculum to humiliate teachers on Are You Smarter Than a Fowler Middle School? Now then, can you please introduce yourself?
Yes, I'm Mr. Madrano, and I teach social studies here in U.S. history at the high school.
Great, man, a few words. Now, Mr. Paterno, do you know what you're doing today?
No, not really. No.
Good, because we're going to surprise you with five questions, fourth grade through eighth grade. And they're all related to your favorite subject, math.
They're all math questions?
They're all math questions.
I see.
Yeah, great. Let's get on with the questions, shall we? Now then, Mr. Paterno, your first question, fourth grade math. What is 5 times 1/2?
Okay, at least one I can do.
Oh, he's cocky, everybody.
You make a fraction out of 5, it would be 5/1, and then you just multiply it out. So that would be 5/2, which is 2.5.
Really? Oh, okay. Who knew he was good at math? Something other than Indiana Jones movies. Now then, let's see if the answer is right. The board says... Mr. Paterno is correct. Wow, okay. What are your thoughts on that, Mr. Paterno, being smarter than fourth grade at all?
That was the fourth grade question.
That was the fourth grade question.
We're going to eighth grade.
We're going to go with eighth grade.
So that was the easiest one I'm going to get there.
Yes, that's
easiest. That's a little concerning.
Yeah, pretty much so. Looks like Harrison Ford would be cringing if he saw that you got that wrong, but it turns out that he is so proud of you. I'm wasting enough time, aren't I? Let's see if you're smarter in the fifth grade.
Welcome back to Madej's Manor Breakdown. I'm your host, John Madej. Today we're going to be looking at how the girls' basketball team attacked a full-court press against Clinton. Clinton's running a full-court press defense, which means that they're going to be playing defense the entire length of the court and not just when the ball crosses half-court like most defenses usually do. This is done to put pressure on the offense, but this also creates opportunities for the offense to exploit this by attacking one-on-one matchups and utilizing the entire length of the court against the defense. When Maynard inbounds the ball, the Clinton defender is going to move in to attack. This means that the inbound man is going to be left wide open so they can pass the ball right back to her. There's the inbound, the defense tries to put pressure at the point of attack, and the defense is going to swarm to collapse. When Maynard passes the ball back, these two Clinton defenders are going to move in to try to trap the player with the ball. This is done to, again, put more pressure on the offense than just having a one-on-one. However, because this is a double team, it also means that someone's going to be left wide open. In this case, Maynard's going to be able to move the ball up and pass the ball here. When this defender vacates her man to try to play defense, she gets left wide open. There, the defense swarms and she's able to get the ball. When she does get the ball, this puts Clinton's defense in a tough situation, as Nina Chiodo is going to be driving from the sideline, but they also have a man in the corner, putting this defender in conflict, as she has two choices, but only one decision. So someone is going to be left wide open. Here, she stays in the middle of the court, meaning a nice pass to Chiodo allows her to drive. This again puts her in a two-on-one situation, as she can either come up and try to play at the point of attack, leaving a potential backdoor cut here, or Maynard can drive and take a layup. There's a good pass, and she's not quite able to close out as she gets too much space, and Maynard's able to finish at the point of attack, easily defeating the full-court press by having good ball movement. That's all for this episode of Madej's Manor Breakdown. I hope you enjoyed the first girls' basketball breakdown of the season, and I'm looking forward to doing more. I've been John Madej, your host of Madej's Manor Breakdown, and I'll see you next episode.
Welcome to today's episode of The To-Go Show, restaurants around the world. Here's my co-host, Jamie Butler.
Hi guys! As you know from this episode, we are going to be reviewing the Cool and Crazy Dining in the Dark experience, and let's kick it to Sophia for more info.
Thanks, Jamie. Located in Boston, Massachusetts, the Hampshire House restaurant includes a vast variety of food, such as seafood, meat, and vegan options. When you go to the restaurant, it will cost you $90. Then you will be seated at a table and immediately blindfolded.
And now that we're back in the studio, we're going to get some food and recreate this Dining in the Dark experience.
We're going to start off by shutting off the lights.
Okay, now that we're back with the lights off and our blindfold on, we're ready to try our Market Basket sushi.
Yeah, and I have my California rolls. Beth has her vegetable rolls. We've got some soy sauce. And we're just going to dive right in. It's said that if you like take one of your senses away, the others are enhanced. So we're going to see if this food tastes any different, any better, any worse, and we'll let you guys know.
So after trying the food with my blindfold on, I can definitely tell a difference. The flavors are very enhanced.
Yeah, I would say I could taste the ingredients a lot, they were a lot stronger.
So yeah, and now we're going to kick it to our future selves to end out our video.
Thank you guys so much for watching this episode of
The To-Go Show.
Restaurants around the world.
Stay tuned in for next week's video.
What up, I'm Nate, and this is College Sports Review. We'll be looking at the New Year's Six Bowls. First up, the College Football Playoff Semifinal, the Cotton Bowl, which is number one Alabama and number four Cincinnati. I think Alabama will blow out Cincinnati.
I said Alabama would blow out Cincinnati in the Cotton Bowl. They did. They won 27-6, although it wasn't as good as an offensive game that I thought they would have. They still came out on top by three touchdowns.
Second is the Orange Bowl, which is the other College Football Playoff Semifinal between number two Michigan and number three Georgia. This will be a closer game, but Georgia will pull out.
Next up, the Orange Bowl between the number two Michigan Wolverines and the number three Georgia Bulldogs. I thought it was going to be a lot closer of a game, but Georgia blew them out 34-11 was the final score.
Third is the Rose Bowl between number six Ohio State and number 11 Utah. Ohio State will be hungry after their loss to Michigan. They'll come out and beat the Utes.
Next up, the Rose Bowl. I thought Ohio State would come out hungry, and they didn't come out that good, but they ended up pulling out the win in one of the best Rose Bowls of all time. Final score is 58-55. Jackson Smith and Jigba had an incredible performance with 347 receiving yards.
Next up, the Sugar Bowl between number 7 Baylor and number 8 Ole Miss. Baylor looked good in the Big 12 championship against Oklahoma State. That's why I'm taking them over Ole Miss.
Next up, the Sugar Bowl between number 7 Baylor and number 8 Ole Miss. I thought Baylor looked good against Oklahoma State in the Big 12 championship. They did come out with the win, as I predicted, 21-7.
Next up, the Fiesta Bowl between number 5 Notre Dame and number 9 Oklahoma State. Notre Dame's looked good ever since their first loss of the season. I think they take this dub.
Next up, the PlayStation Fiesta Bowl between Notre Dame and Oklahoma State. I thought Notre Dame was going to win. They had the lead for a long time, but Oklahoma State ended up having a good comeback and winning by 2 points, 37-35.
Last up is the Chick-fil-A Peach Bowl between the number 10 ranked Michigan State Spartans and the number 12 Pitt Panthers. Michigan State's going to take this because of Kenneth Walker, and Pitt does not have their superstar quarterback and Heisman finalist, Kenny Pickett.
Next up, the Chick-fil-A Peach Bowl between the number 10 Michigan State Spartans and the number 12 Pittsburgh Panthers. I thought Pitt wouldn't have a chance without Kenny Pickett. They kept the game close, ended up losing 31-21, even though Kenneth Walker didn't play for Michigan State. Thank you for watching College Sports Review.
You win!
football. And now, Super Bowl predictions.
Our first prediction comes from Mr. Paterno. What's your prediction on the Super Bowl?
I'm going to go with Rams over the Bengals, 35-17.
All right.
24-14, Bengals.
That's such high hopes.
I believe the Bengals are going to win 28-17.
I think the Rams will win 28-23.
I got the Bengals winning 27-13.
I think the Bengals will win 21-14.
I'm gonna go 31-27 Rams.
I've got Bengals winning 34-31.
Where am I? Who are you people?
To be honest, I have absolutely no idea who's playing.
So my prediction is that in the final 2 minutes, Matt Stafford drives the length of the field, throwing his fourth touchdown pass of the game in the final minute for an absolute stinker of a Super Bowl. Rams win 27-10.
Hi, I'm Sophia, and I think the Bengals are gonna win because they're the underdog, and I think it's gonna be 26-32.
I think, I don't really know, but if I had to choose, I'd say Bengals, and if I had to choose a score, predict the score, I would say 26-17.
I think the Rams are gonna win because the Bengals have not won a Super Bowl in how many years was it? 40 years? So yeah, that's why I think the Rams will win.